Ladies and gentlemen, what is up? It is Championship Sunday, and we are moments away from the finals matchup here. I'm DJ Wheat.
And I am Day 9, two ex-teammates from Team TSL. Now on separate teams, going to be facing off in a grand final best of five.
Now, we didn't want to keep you guys waiting too long. We do have a little bit longer until the final actually begins, but you know, I'd just like to say, good job, MLG. Everything's been running on time all weekend. We've been able to fill in with some extra matches. So just want to give a round of applause to the guys back there in production and all the folks organizing this. Thank you, guys. Additionally, Sean, because we're getting near the end of the event, it's last chance. You know, you guys have probably seen the Revolt PCs from iBuyPower around the event, and we've had different casters, players, and personalities signing these over the course of the weekend, and visit the iBuyPower booth here for a chance to win one of these signed Revolt systems, or head on over to iBuyPower.com/MLG. There's also the same systems that everyone is playing here for the tournaments, whether it be League of Legends or StarCraft II.
Yeah, we actually have them right here, casting from them as well. I'd like to once again, before we head out to a brief break, give a shout out to the most central figure, most inspirational and awesome, the audience at MLG Anaheim. You guys are amazing. There are so many people here. It is packed. There's not even enough space. It is a fire hazard of awesomeness, DJ.
I think that's a great way to describe it, Sean. The energy in this room is phenomenal. I know that we've got two players here that have probably split fans across the board. Both of these players have been building up this hype and this anticipation throughout this competition, and I think this is set up to be a phenomenal finals. We also have a third guest here on the caster desk.
Yes.
This, of course, the Pro Tour Trophy, because today one of these players is going to be winning $10,000. I should also note this is a WCS Tier 1 event, so 750 points on the line for that as well. But yes, joining us is going to get in between us.
I know. I mean, sometimes I might lean in and get excited, and even if we bump it, it's okay. These are like really heavy, high-quality trophies. I still remember in the early days of MLG handing it to some Korean players. Ugh, I have to lift it up high. When we come back, guys, we're going to be getting into game number one and best of five between the two players who have looked nigh undefeatable all tournament long. Who will win? CM Storm's Pult or Quantix Yun? Stay tuned. We'll be back.
Baraka pass to break this army. There's no Marines. They ditched the tanks.
Oh no, the Hellbat's gonna be dropped on top. SDC is gonna lose every single one of his tanks. Bros being pulled, but the SDC is coming at the perfect moment here.
We began with 128 professional StarCraft II Heart of the Swarm players, and we are finally down to two. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready for the finals? A best of five between two currently unbeaten individuals, slaying amazing players left and right, and I have the pleasure to be able to interview both of them before we begin. First off, I want to invite to the stage a Terran player who currently attends the University of Texas. He lives in Texas right now. Representing CM Storm, I give you Pult. Pult, before we get started, do you have any words for this remarkable crowd in front of us?
I'm living in the U.S. right now, so you already know who will you cheer for.
I have to ask, you're coming off of a match against Naniwa, where you showed very convincing play. What were the words that y'all exchanged in the booth after the game ended?
That was just, I told him, just, you can choose that. I'm telling the Naniwa, you can choose that. Keep doing BM or just be fine. And he decided to keep BMing forever.
Your match in the final is going to be a best of five against Hyun. Can you tell me a little bit about your history with Hyun and your thoughts about him as a player?
He was my teammate when I was in TSL. And he was a very strong player. And he even got the runner-up in the GSL. And he's still doing very well at recent tournaments. So it'll be a very tough match. But this is the finals, and it's the first time to be the finals in this year for me, and it's been so long time, so I'm so excited right now, and I'll do just my best.
My last question for you is, do you have any words for your opponent before this match begins?
You did a good job till the finals, but I think the trophy is mine.
Guys, give it up for Pult! Of course, Pult's opponent is a Zerg player representing Quantic Gaming. He has yet to lose a set, just took down one of the best Protosses in the world, Hero, 4-1. I want you guys to make some noise for Quantic's Hyun! We're gonna stick to the same sort of questions for you, Hyun. First, I would like you to address this audience. Do you have anything to say to them before we advance into the final match of the tournament?
이제 결승 시작하기 전에 팬들에게 한마디 해준다면
I love America. Cheer for me. Not Pult.
Can you talk a little bit about your history with Pult personally and what you think of him as a player as far as how he has performed in this tournament thus far?
폴트 선수와 전에 만났을 때 어땠는지 그리고 폴트 선수의 개인적으로 어떻게 생각하는지
일단 4개월 전에 IPL 그 큰 쇼매치를 했었는데 제가 6대3으로 이긴 적이 있어서 그 기억을 잘 살려가지고 최선을 다할 거고요. 개인적으로 예전에 같은 멤버였기 때문에 친하지만 누구보다 스타일을 잘 알고 있다고 생각을 해서 그 점을 잘 생각해서 플레이하겠습니다.
4 months ago, we actually Lee had an IPL show match, and I won 6-3. So I'm just gonna bring back those memories and beat him like that. Also, before, you know, we've been teammates before, so I actually know his style very well. So, you know, even though we're close, you know, I'll make sure to beat him.
My final question for you. Do you have any words for your opponent before this final match begins?
결승 시작하기 전에 최성훈 선수에게 한마디만 해주세요.
좋은 게임 했으면 좋겠고 최근에 쇼매치에서 그때도 제가 트로피를 가져갔거든요. 이번에도 제가 가져가도록 하겠습니다.
I hope we can show good games and also last time I took the trophy. So this time I'm going to take the trophy too.
One last time guys, give it up for Hyun! All right, the stage is set, a best of five between Paul and Hyun to find out who's gonna become the 2013 MLG Spring Championship. Before we get to the casters, I'm proud to announce this weekend we have shattered previous MLG records with more than 21,000 attendees over 3 days. Guys, give yourself a round of applause for that. We are also incredibly excited to announce the date and location of our next Pro Circuit event. It will be in Columbus, Ohio from November 22nd through 24th. So if you haven't already, book your ticket right now. It is gonna be phenomenal. And that being said, guys, we are ready for the final between Hyun and Polt. And of course, to bring you excellent commentary as always, I present Day 9 in DJ Week.
Axeltoss, thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, we started out on Friday, and as Axel mentioned earlier, we are down to just two players. And Sean, there is a ridiculous amount of cool stats surrounding these two players.
First and
foremost, if Polt wins this, it will be the completion of the Triple Crown for him. He's won an event in Korea, he's won an event in Europe, but he's yet to grab one here in the U.S.
Players like MVP, MC have done this before. Polt would love to be up at the top with those greats. These two players, even just in this very tournament, have shown amazing play. I mean, Hyun looked unstoppable in Zerg vs. Protoss, rounding out the whole tree so fast with the Ling Roach Hydra Viper play. We haven't got the chance to see him pull out some really crazy stops against Terran yet. But as we know, Terran versus Zerg has been an increasingly volatile, difficult matchup for both sides. The Biomine play is overpowering so many Zergs in the late game, but so many Zergs have begun throwing in Roach, Baneling, Ling all-ins in the early game. How is Polt going to readjust? It is one of the most tumultuous metagame matchups as of yet.
And we've seen quite a few TVZs here during the MLG Spring Championship, but interestingly enough, both of these players throughout the competition has only been in this matchup one time. For Polt, coming through the winner's bracket, he went through three Terrans and then had his first TVZ, that was versus Suppy. Over on Hyun's side, he went through a ton of Zergs and a Protoss, and then his first TVZ was actually versus Sound. So.
Yeah.
These guys, you know, are playing now another TVZ, have only faced this matchup one time in the competition. And I have to tell you, I mean, the way that Hyun has been playing, the way that he looked, he is, I think, one of the strong favorites for this. I think Polt has a tough battle in front of him. I really do.
Hyun, as he said before, went 6-3 with Polt. They both know each other's styles very, very well. First map is going to be on Akalon Waste. Mech, absolutely possible. Bio, absolutely possible. No matter what, it's all going to be about the big defense from Hyun in the late game and the big defense from Polt in the early game. Ladies and gentlemen, the players have just said that they are ready. Are you ready for the grand final of MLG 2013 Spring Championship?
Yeah. We've been waiting 3 days for this moment, culminating in this finals matchup. One of my favorites, a TVZ, Hyun versus Pult. Very excited, and we're gonna get this room shaking. Here's Agilon Wace, and as you mentioned, Sean, as we're going into this first matchup, we've seen Pult play some really remarkable games on this one, but this was also the location for one of my favorite games this weekend, which was Hyun versus Hero. It was a remarkable game. And now let's introduce our players for game number one.
Spawning in the top left-hand corner, currently residing in the U.S., but still lacks a championship on U.S. soil. Can he seize his first one today from Cooler Master Storm? It is Pult!
And in the southeast position, as the red Zerg, he has torn through every single opponent he has faced in this competition, and now he is up versus Pult from Team Quantic. Give it up for Hyun!
Very tricky map. No real good center position. And in some of the other matchups, it means that engagements get delayed or kind of come at awkward angles. But Terran players are going to be seizing every opportunity to drop, to
right.
Squeeze around. Oh, your circles are on that side. I'll move along to the other side of the center slit. Pult is opening up immediately, getting a geyser. He wants to get that Reaper up immediately. So, of course, he can begin scouting. He can begin harassing. Hyun, thus far, playing very standard.
Yep, I mean, Reaper pretty standard opening here on this, just considering the cliffs and all the entrances that you can get into. Quick scouting into the natural and then directly into the main is always a really nice way to start off this map here on Terran. The drone scout is out, and this first SCV down to 10 hit points, he might actually go down. That drone is going to chase away, but the Rax continues and finishes up. That drone, he wants that SCV. There's the quick repair. Already some early game shenanigans going out, but that SCV will not fall. We have not had first blood quite yet, Sean.
Neither player lost anything yet. Reaper en route. Now, from a Zerg's position, there's a number of big plays that we can end up seeing as the game goes on. One of the more common ones nowadays is big speed roach busts. We saw Suppy do that successfully against Pult on Belshir Vestige. At the same time, the Ling Muta Baneling play, we also see still staying in the game, but behaving completely differently. The Mutalisk's suddenly a defensive tool. Second Reaper coming out, that's always a sign that Pult is going to be going Command Center, Hellion, and then straight to a third Command Center.
Now, I mean, in some of Pult's earlier games, he was really mixing up some drop play with just some bio aggression, using bio mines very effectively.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I do think that he's going to be going for these similar types of attacks, especially here on Agilon Wace. Now, where we've seen Hyun so powerful is getting past those moments. The same kind of thing happened with Sound, is when he can get past there, and then he gets that really incredible 200 army that he can just continuously replenish. And Hyun has been playing some phenomenal macro games, as we saw in his games VT, in his games V Protoss as well. And here we have the Reaper doing his thing.
Yeah, traditionally macro has been very, very strong against Terran. It's the style that you just pretty much want to play in this matchup. But as of late, we've been seeing Terrans be so aggressive that Zergs never get the opportunity to do that. Even in 30, 40 minute long games, Zergs constantly bouncing between 100 and 150 supply. Hellion's coming up for Pult. No sign of third Command Center quite yet, although he does have the money for it.
Yeah, is he gonna, I don't know, drop it, wait till this other Command Center's done? I doubt he'll drop it on the low ground here. He's gonna make a switch over to the reactor, already getting that bunker at the front, as the Overlord's gonna come in and see that the CC's finishing up there on the low ground. Second Overlord going in to the main base while the Reaper is making his way back around. He's not gonna see a whole lot. He is gonna be able to note there's two drones on gas, and then he's going to get out of there.
Oh, nice micro there by Pult. Man, just to worm his way out of all sorts of danger. He did see that there was an extra 100 gas mine, and I'm actually kind of asking myself, what on earth is Hyun wanting to do with that extra gas? Often players will do this, freaking out their opponent, make them think something big and scary is coming up, but you know, yeah, doing the mind games. But in reality, players will just throw down two Evo chambers and swiftly get those upgrades up, or just go for roaches. So now with the Hellion Reaper up, the Overlord has scouted a fast Viking play from Pult.
Polta did something similar here yesterday as well, where he used this sort of Hellion Reaper combo at the front. Hold on, we have some Lings making their way right past that bunker that's completely empty. They'll split off and try to take out maybe one mule, possibly a second as well. And that's actually going to be a good little pickup there for Hyun. You can't get that second one. He might be able to get inside the main base. No, the depots go up, and the Hellions move back out.
We have yet to see any sort of stim occur. Hyun's just playing a pretty typical timing, taking his third base. We see the Spore Crawler going up in the main just in case there's just mines and or Banshee. And Hyun's actually feeling a little confused, so he says, you know what, I'm going to get Overlord speed. I want to scout in there. We see his Overlord moving in. I mean, I think he's asking the same question we are. Where the heck did that third command center go? And there, finally, we see it go down.
Yeah, drop down inside the main. Viking also out for Polt, helping to clear out some of those Overlords near the base, which does make it a little bit tougher. Like you mentioned, that Overlord speed is going to come in big. Zergling's trying to swing around, and this is where this composition is really interesting early in the TVZ, because the Reapers are so fast, the Lings want to get in there and take them out, but then the Hellions just completely annihilate them. So I really love this for control. And this third base is finally completed now for Hyun. He's got his first roaches out, so he can start to defend and really populate that and get it all droned up.
Gosh, I mean, if I am Pult, I'm going to be kind of confused as to where on earth are these overlords. You know, he built a Viking, he scouted early on, but we've seen Hyun plant everything absolutely perfectly, and it looks like Pult, looks like he got a little over-eager. He's going to lose one Hellion. Still has not really found any other overlords with that Viking. But we see Pult pulling back, and he's going straight into standard bio mine. The two engineering bays are very early. He's still building mines at the front in case of any bust. He's building early marauders preemptively, again, in case of any bust. But Hyun is pulling very reserved. No aggression coming up. Going for the evolution chambers for the upgrades. And again, it looks like, Pult has got himself cornered.
Yeah, he's going to maybe try to run back in. He knows he's going to lose these units. There's a few left. Drones take some damage going through, but only one falls. Ugh. And the queen should be able to clean this up, no problem. There is the lair morphing as well. The overlords with their speed now back into the main base of the Terran to check things out. That Reaper going to make its way where I'm. Well, he's going to get out of there. No, he's not.
Well, you know, I mean, Hyun went to the main base, saw everything, and said, perfect. Your extra barracks are only starting just now, so you know what? I'm just going to go straight for my upgrades, my extra gases.
And
he built 16 drones at once, and yep, like you say, fourth base going down at bottom mid. That Viking still hasn't found a second Overlord to kill.
Yeah, and now with speed going to make it a little bit more difficult. We do have a first drop coming out for Polt, making its way through the center of the map. It has got three Marauders and two Marines inside. Finally, that Viking does find another Overlord and takes him out. Hyun immediately getting back into supply. Good green on that. And here's a drop taken out of Creep Tumor. Now going to throw it down on the third. Queen will deflect it. And it looks like Pult's initial drop play is going to be denied.
This is kind of an interesting play from Pult. He's lost his Reaper and his Hellions. He didn't build a ton at the start of the game, but you know, you almost always want to keep those alive as long as you can. However, look at this follow-up drop from Pult. Kind of interesting. Still exploiting the fact that it's largely a Roach army, but Hyun also doing something very old school, something that Brutal War players did a lot. He's getting Overlord speed, and he's making kind of a ring in the middle of the map to make sure he can spot everything, flying, ground, all of it.
And that drop in the middle continues to do some harassment here with these Roaches in the center. Taking a look quickly at the production of Pult, he did add some additional racks on top of the two more. I think that puts him up to about five total. And Stim is going to be completing here very soon, which of course can make those drops just absolutely effective. Now the fourth base is up for Hyun, and he's starting to get that up. No gases there quite yet. But where is he going with this off of the lair tech? We see Baneling speed. We're going to have plus one finishing, melee and carapace, and then Roach speed also finishing up here. Are we just going to have a massive swell of units and attempt to move forward? Based off of the fact that we haven't seen any other attack to accompany this, I think that's what's next.
Yeah, I mean, like, it used to be Zergs were trying to tech as fast as they could, get Infestors or Spire, and then soon enough Hive for Ultralisks and whatnot, as fast as they could. But now, with Biomine, with tanks being gone, Roaches and Banelings are way stronger. So we're seeing Hyun go for everything in the layer tech. But Baneling speed isn't done yet. Pult's beginning to try to engage off creep, but God, Hyun has so many units.
Yeah, he does. And, once Baneling speed hits here, this is going to be a much easier engagement. But he's going to go in for it anyway.
Uh-oh.
There's the stim, the pickup almost immediately. Medivac's going to get out of there and immediately go into the third. The army of Hyun's going to rotate on over. And Noah going to go immediately into the main and can play elevator up and down. But look at Hyun splitting his units on both sides, not giving Pult an opportunity to go in, and he must vacate the premise.
And this is what's so scary about what Pult's doing right now. It's not that Hyun protected both, so boom, he deflected it all. It's just that nothing happens. All those units are still alive. The threat is still there. He needs to make sure he controls well enough. And that Viking up in the top corner, remember how I said he didn't find a target for a long time? Well, he has five kills now. Look at Paul sprinting down with so much Biomine. He's getting ready to join up with his medevacs for a big engagement, and he's slowly clearing out the top end. Hyun's vision is just evaporating a little bit at a time.
And you know what? He needs to focus his vision on what's happening right here. We've got about 10 mines going down. They're going to go down. Are they going to get burrowed in time?
Oh my God.
The Zerglings surrounded from all errors, and now the Roaches are coming in. Zerglings still managed to break through here. The Banelings are going to hit as well, and that army is going to get disintegrated. Only two Marines and a Marauder are picked up.
But look at this. DJ Wheat in the main base. We see a drop from Pult. All the units of Hyun began to move out, but then seeing the drop had to split back, and it's going to be a lot harder to break those units into two pieces. Pult now can do a two-phase aggression load up and head to that third base, but look at Hyun. Look at how many spores he has. He has six spore colonies just at that bottom fourth. He's making so many more spore crawlers in his main. Oh my God, he hates medevacs, man.
He hates the medevacs indeed, and now we're going to have Hyun moving out once again. Keep in mind, those two medevacs are still back there.
Oh, mine's in mid.
He never cleaned those up from the previous engagement. Got some Banelings kind of sitting out here. He's going to need to get some Overseers out. We see Burrow as well, along with Neural Parasite.
This is such a fascinating play from Hyun. You know, the biggest problem that this Lair-esque style had, a lot of Ling, Roach, Baneling. Oh, big engagement in mid. He's just trying to bait back into the mine, and he's going to do it, and bam, picking off all those links. What? How on earth did that happen?
And there's the pickup. Holt's going to be able to get away once again, definitely choosing. Ooh, and look at that. He's got another hold minefield behind that, possibly trying to bait his opponent in. Pathogen Glands is finishing up, not Neural Parasite. It's going to be done soon. That means the Infestors are going to be out there. Of course, making the Ling Bane Roach combo even more powerful than what it is. Now, will we see Hyun run into this minefield that Pult has been set up quite nicely? And we've seen that happen before, where the Terran sets up these minefields. He's going for it. He's going to try to bait him back into it. A couple more Widow Mines coming in, but again, a pickup. They are going to get the burrow. They're going to onto the army of Pult. Medivacs taking some big hits there, and we'll see Hyun move forward.
There's a lot of mines in this middle area. Hyun does not want to be here, but in he marches. Amazing connections on all the Roaches. Pult is going to be able to drive this backward. Hyun has to retreat for now. Pult supply leads 185 to 164. But look at this. Down in the bottom left hand, there is no way you'll ever be able to break through that line of spore crawlers. I mean, Hyun has denied any engagement on that line, so Pult is pushing strong north.
Oh, and there the Infestors come out. Two great fungals go down.
A third
to lock it. The Lings will clean everything up, and all that's left is medevac. However, keep in mind with the minefield out front, I don't see an Overseer anywhere nearby, so he can't just follow up with an additional attack. With that being said, the third,
I mean, we're seeing down in the bottom left, there's these two medevacs with all these units for Pult, and they're just sitting there. They can't drop anywhere. The bottom flank is completely protected. The reason Biomine is such an effective force is that you're splitting the Zerg up. The drop strike deal damage even if the main force falls, but no drops can happen in this spot. But Pult, he's not one to play one-dimensionally. He's going to continue expanding. He's going to start playing strong, muscular Terran. We're seeing him increase his composition of Marauders. He's got 3-3 and plus 2 incoming. Hyun manages to spot the medevacs. His Overlords might be dead, but he has burrowed Link spotting along that side as well. Hyun up to five bases. Ultra Cavern wrapping up. Adrenaglands 3-3 incoming.
We've got an attack here at the fifth base of Hyun. Small bio force going to come out. There's some Banelings get a hit, mostly on Marauders. And we'll eventually clean that up and get them out of there. Pult's taking another base behind this as well. Keep in mind, the Ultra Cavern just completed. 3-3s have started. And we've got Adrenal Glands as well.
I mean, watching these two players play is amazing. I mean, very clearly the best two players in this tournament battling it out, and they are very evenly matched. Two medevacs not doing general drops, but sort of waltzing forward. These Infestors.
Oh, he's got to be careful. He lands one fungal. Great job. He's going to come in with the army. He won't be able to pick up because the Infestors continue to lock down, and a big win there for Hyun.
And up at the top side, a couple of Marauders trying to step in. Spore crawlers line the top side. Nice burrow to hide. The queen has to load up, has to run. neither player really seems to be able to break the other one, but Hyun making 70 Zerglings.
Oh my goodness, and also getting the chitinous plating. He's definitely going to be loading up for his ultras. It'll be coming here eventually. The southwest base, set up as a planetary fortress for Polt, is probably going to be a vulnerable location once these ultras are out. But we haven't quite seen them hit yet. Whoa. I don't think we're out in the field.
They're going to be vulnerable right now with that many Veilings morphing. Polt trying to hold that watchtower, beginning to add in Ravens as he slowly transitions up to battlecruisers. The fusion core is done. The fusion core dance has not yet started. Up the top side, a couple burrowed lanes get picked off by Polt. Army for Hyun, just dancing back and forth through the middle. This is such a tense game. There really hasn't been a huge engagement yet.
No, and now that force is moving back over to the southwest side, the new base for Polt. He's going to surround with these units, and he might be able to get out of there, and he will. The infestors are there, but they're burrowed. The planetary fortress is going to be going.
Oh, the north base.
Uh-oh, it's going to be attacked at the exact same time. By the way, everything's going to fall in Polt's base. Meanwhile, on the other side,
I mean, we're seeing, looks like Polt has managed to break through. He split his forces up. Everything Hyun is down in the bottom left. The infestors are preparing to move in, but there are mines littered absolutely everywhere. Hyun will not be able to save his top right expansion. Polt has managed to even up the base count 4-4.
A couple of Zerglings going to come out, try to clean this up, but the point of that mission was to get rid of that hatchery, and it does go down the infestors.
There's Ravens.
Oh my
there's
gosh. Oh, oh my no. gosh. He's got to be so careful. He sends out a couple of infested Terrans, but there comes the rest of his army. He drops down the fungals, and he's still going to be able to get in here, and another bio force gets disintegrated.
A single battlecruiser in production now. The bio army, very small for Polt. 6 Marauders, 12 Marines, and that is it. It is 21 mines eating up almost all of the supply for Polt. He is essentially relying entirely on the defensive on those mines. He is staying pulled back. 3 battlecruisers now in production now. The Terran ship and vehicle plating level 3 coming up. Corvid reactor done. That's the energy upgrade for those Ravens. For, you know, those of you who don't memorize all the names of the upgrades in the game like I do.
We'll now, we're at 200-200. Amazing compositions on both sides, Sean. The one thing is, look at the bank of Polt compared to Hyun at this point, 2,700. Yep. And you know what that can mean. It's like the reinforcements. Here we go. Blinding Cloud goes down. It's not going to matter. The pickup. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, my gosh. 59 Banelings.
Oh, my.
59 Banelings. There's too many mines. There's too many mines.
Oh, my gosh. There are so many mines. They're going in there to take it out. Meanwhile, we got a drop at the third as well. Polt is getting broken here at his front. There's still so many mines, Sean. Oh, the altar's still going to move forward, but is it enough? Meanwhile, the third base isn't going to go down. No, it's been completely cleaned up by Hyun.
Couple Seeker missiles try to get launched. Polt traps them in. Hello, battlecruisers. Welcome to the party. 17 Marines on the map. The bottom base of Hyun taking some serious hits, but it doesn't quite look like Polt has been broken.
No, not quite yet. The ultras are going to try to get as deep as they can. Following up behind this, we've got another like 44 Zerglings, and that's where a lot of the bank went to. But look at all the flashing on the mini-wap. There are attacks coming out everywhere from Hyun at the natural, the third, going into the main. Here comes a huge reinforcement. Most of the mines have been cleared out, so all these Zerglings are making their way into Polt's base.
Uh-oh. Polt's main. So important to keep that staying alive. Polt is trying to find a good angle for his Marine Marauder to be able to stay alive. And right now, Hyun's realizing he needs to deal damage. Now, look at that mini-map. A trail of red bleeding straight into Polt's base. The third getting ravaged by just a handful of Zerglings. These battlecruisers are going to have to be it. But keep in mind, battlecruisers fire small shots very rapidly. The +3 armor on the Ling Ultra is going to mean that it is almost no damage being dealt. But oh my god, Hyun doesn't have a Spire yet.
No, he does not. He has put it down. It's halfway done. This is not necessarily something he's anticipated, but I think he's making the right decisions, taking out the southwest base yet again. The natural is still getting ravaged here. It finally is lifted, and the roaches are killed. Really, the only mining base at this point is that third base for Polt, just south of his natural, but he's got to pull back. Suddenly, Hyun can't finish the game because the battlecruisers are in there. He doesn't have the same bank that he had as he went into that final engagement.
Hyun is broke at this point in time, and keep in mind, look at the unit count. 70 drones, but 38 SCVs. That means that Polt's army supply is at 100, while Quantic Hyun's is only at 70. So currently, Polt has a significantly larger army, and he has 6 orbital commands. He's going to be able to rely almost exclusively on mules, and we see them dropping very rapidly down in the bottom left. 3 more Ravens coming up. That will bring the count all the way up to 8. 3 battlecruisers in production, and we're seeing Polt not overcommit to battlecruisers. He just wants to try to bait out too much anti-air from Hyun, but Hyun already has a clear plan.
He
Queen,
does.
Infestor, Ultra.
Yeah, Festers, we are seeing Neural Parasite finally come out now, where the Queens are coming in to also transfuse the Ultras. This is going to be a hard army to make this work, to control all these units. There are three different casters in there, including the Overseers. And, well, here we go. I think he's going to go in for it, Sean.
He's got to be careful to keep those Overseers alive. These Ultras are doing their best to tank the damage. But uh-oh, he's got to be careful. Neural Parasite is going to ruin his day. He's picked off all the Overseers with those Vikings, and here's the Secret Missile.
The Infestors die. All the Infested Terrans go out, but we only have one Valkyrs. No, two more coming
a
to reinforce.
Ultra. It's just Queens. It's just Queens versus this Bio Force, and the Battlecruiser are taking everything out. Quantic Heal Supply is dropped to 128. Pulse, who is on the verge of defeat. So much transfused. The Suppy-style Ultralisk leading the charge.
Oh my god, two more Battlecruisers left. There's the Neural Parasite on the Battlecruiser turning the tides. Three more Ultras coming in to help his brothers, and the Queens are remaining alive. He brings one of the Battlecruisers back now, focuses attention, but the Vikings are out now as well, and the Ultras are shooting forward. The Bio is still exists. This is a back and forth battle, but Hyun is down to 102 supply.
And the Ultralists are slowly falling. The energy's out. There's no more transfuse. There's no more transfuse. He overruns the Queen. Four bases versus five. Bolt has taken down the fight. 120 supply to 163, but Hyun is not done yet. 60 more lings and 8 Infestors in production.
We hit this 30-minute mark, Sean. Back and forth battle. Polt still wants to get this base going. He's recreated that southwest base, and Mule drops galore to fund him for the next few minutes. But all those Zerglings you were talking about, they're heading over there right now, and those Mules are not going to get a full days of work in.
Uh-oh, the Mules just landed. All the energy just expended. Hyun does a perfect surround timing. There is going to be no way to get there in time, or is there? All the Bio's in there. They're rushing in. There's the restim. It's getting low. It's getting low. And it falls. But Hyun has lost almost all of his Zerglings from 60 down to 12.
Yeah, and you know what? There are still orbitals in play here. There's a planetary at that third. Now orbitals moving over, so it wasn't a huge loss for Polk. He retains a lot of his army right now, sitting at 125 supply to 67 supply for Hyun. And he looked like he had everything he needed, every answer in the game. But a great engagement by Polk takes it to a third chapter here. A lot of Infestors out, but the unit count, 13 Infestors, 5 Lings, 3 Ultras, and just a single Queen.
Remarkable game number one. Even though Pult has a completely different composition, it's going to function nearly the same way. He's going to take these small bits of forces forward and try to pick these units off, but it looks like that is a lot of Infestors, a lot of vulnerable Infestors. The Queens are nowhere near to try to do any transfuse. It looks like Pult is going to stop harassing. It's time for him to move in and try to go for the kill.
Unfortunately, the Infestors used most of their energy on Fungals there, and that means that there's not going to be a whole lot, maybe a couple of Neural Parasites. I think this could be a killing blow here for Pult. He moves closer. Transfuse continuing to go down to these Ultras.
Yamato's picks off 1, 2, 3 Ultralisks almost immediately. Great stims, amazing manipulation of this landscape by Pult. A ton of Infested Terrans get thrown down. Here come the Seeker missiles, and bam, connection. All the Queens can only transfuse each other for a few more moments, and Pult storming in with the remainder of his bio. A couple of Infestors head down to the bottom left. What does Hyun have to fight this?
I don't think he can do it. Everything has been taken out. Two Ultras of 14 Lings. Unfortunately, those Lings can't fly, and that means that Pult just has this unbelievable air army and is probably going to be able to take all this out.
A couple of Infestors are going to try to harass this bottom left base. It looks like Pult trying to control too much action at once, doesn't notice, but he's taken out the top right base from Hyun, which means that the only mining location for Pult is the left base. Hyun is broke. He has nothing else left. These are all the drones. Everything is getting devoured up at the top side.
I don't think any amount of Infestors can stop this at this point. He's got everything he's needed. Ravens now, you know, the moment that those Hunter Seeker missiles come out, there's not much that he can do, even the burrow and the run. And Pult, though, he's not going in quite yet.
I think Hyun is just thinking he has one big play left.
Yeah.
Only build Infestors and get perfect Neural Parasites off. But I don't even know if he can do that. The mines are just placed too well.
And yeah, I don't know if that could happen either. He still needs quite a bit of energy on these investors too. Does he have that much time to spare? There's the lift, some more mules drop, scan to see what exactly the army is. And now he's moving over. And with this bio slash Viking Raven battle cruiser set, can he do it? Kyan is getting blocked off from his main as well. He's being pushed Kyan further
surrounded.
And further back.
Kyan is surrounded. He's trying to find a way out. He controls the watchtower. He sees that all the exits are blocked. Fungal growth on the battlecruiser. Can he get a key neural parasite off? There's one, there's two, there's three.
Oh my
Yamato-ing. He's Yamato-ing all of Kyan. Oh my god, Kyan is going to try to Yamato as best he can, but there's too much bio. There's too much everything. Pulse, a stunning finish to game number one. All of the investors get Yamato. The last ultra is GG!
Unbelievable game, Sean, to kick off the finals here for the MLG Spring Championship. Holt takes game number one in almost a 35-minute, 36-minute game that went back and forth.
A game that defied analysis by all means. I mean, the start of it, you always talk about BioMind trying to stay alive at the layer tech stage, but I mean, Hyun locked himself down with so many spore crawlers. What was Paul to do? He took it to the late game. Mines, Ravens, Vikings, and there was a moment where Hyun looked inches away from taking that win. He had broken the front. His Ultralisks were not dying. He had so many queens there for transfuse, but Pult just kept carefully repositioning, carefully microing, and a couple battlecruisers saved the day.
When you saw that amount of reinforcements come in after the front wall was broken, it was hard to go, how is Pult going to be able to come back from this? But like timing and foreshadowing by Pult and almost you're looking into the future and going, this is how I'm going to be able to come out of this hole. And just absolutely incredible. I thought for certain Hunt Young was going to finish the game right there. And Pult defies and takes game number one. Unbelievable. We are going to take a quick break. When we come back, game two as this incredible finals continues for the MLG Spring Championship. I'm DJ Wheat.
I'm Day 9. Stay tuned because the finals have only just gotten started.
break this army. There's no Marines. They ditched the tanks.
Oh no, the Hellbat's gonna be dropped on top. SDC is gonna lose every single one of it takes. Pros being pulled, but the SDC's coming at the perfect moment here.
Oh man, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. In the break, Marcus and I still talking about that amazing game one. And in a moment, we're gonna hop into the game, do a little bit of the NAS performance replay analysis to see that huge money moment. But I mean, the start of the game happened so oddly. Normally we see this as a matchup where there's a ton of little tiny fights happening all over the place, and it's who can have the best multitasking to be able to win the game. Who can handle dealing with the drops, the mutals, the zerglings, and this sort of thing. Rarely do we actually see two big armies just engaging each other directly in this matchup.
Yeah, I mean, when it culminated up to that point, we had so many small engagements, right, that led to the massive one that we're hopefully going to see here pretty soon. But Holt's drops were shut down, which meant that he was doing a lot of, you know, creep cleanup and trying to harass different areas of the map. But, you know, ultimately, I think, you know, once Holt put together that minefield, not only in front of Hyun's natural, but then also in front of his natural, he got that control that ultimately really helped out in this engagement, and I think we've got a load of that.
Yeah, I mean, like, this is the key moment where everything got started. We got the chance to see this huge force come and actually have the unit tab open, because there's a lot of unusual mixtures in this. I mean, most notably, we see the five queens, this big set of banelings getting ready to move in. Again, rarely do we see these huge clumps, but it was all thanks to these spore crawlers down at the bottom side that allowed Hyun to really get to this part. This top base is going to be able to get reformed. And as we swiftly go through this segment, this was really the moment where everyone was saying, yep, Hyun totally unable to break through after losing so many banelings in that first hit. But then suddenly, the Ultralisks continue to break through. There was this micro bout at the backside. So in this moment, clear that Hyun is going to be able to, that Polt is going to be able to hold this off. I mean, Ultralisk obviously can't shoot up. But Hyun keeps building no anti-air. Lings and Ultralisk just trying to flood and break, flood and break, flood and break, keep going in. So Polt was looking kind of shaky. But the more important thing that Hyun was doing this entire time was picking off these expansions. Overall, this wound up being a big gain for Hyun. And this is where things got really crazy. We start to see that the queen count has popped up to 10. We see those 10 infestors. And we see over in the unit count for Polt, not a lot of good units. Mainly Vikings, some Ravens, some Battlecruisers. Why are those not good units in this spot? Because these queens can infinitely transfer these Ultralisks, and most importantly, these infestors are going to just rock everything. Easy neural parasites, easy fungals on this small number. And it was this key shot. Polt sweeps down the left flank and sees with these great scans exactly where all the infestors are. And look at how much purple energy is on those. Immediately all gets spent because Hyun knows they're not going to be staying alive long. Suddenly all the battle cruisers that could have been easily picked off by a couple neural parasites, not a threat at all anymore. And it's just queens and a single ultra, which by all measures stayed alive for longer than he should have, but still not going to be enough. And as we get out of that NAS performance replay analysis, game number two is ready, and the map is going to be Belshir Vestige.
I'm going to be bringing you back in here, and then we'll go ahead and get this one started. Oh, you're already in. Look at that.
Well, I'm ready. Marcus is ready. Players are ready. And of course, I know that the crowd here in Anaheim is ready.
You guys have been great all weekend. The countdown for game two is about to begin. Belshir Vestige is our map. And before we get started, Polt fans out there? Any, maybe? Any Hyun fans out there? Also, before we get started, I want to give a shout out to all the Barcrafts out there. Love the pictures you've been sending us. Totally awesome. And you know, I wish I was at one. Watching the finals right now, but
no, that's so untrue.
I'm
Marcus
lying.
And I get the front row seat.
We
get to control where we look. And of course, and you know, there's one person, a sort of hidden person, our observer.
Give him a round of applause, our observer.
Yes. Oh, Oh, the game crashed.
Holtz decided he's going to play this game with his mind, which is why he's currently standing in his booth. we're going to have a remake here.
No doubt. You know, I want to talk a little bit about Belcher Vestige as it contrasts with Acolon Waste. We see four bases, very easy to get, five if you're Hyun. Polt was bouncing between four and five. That fifth base always very, very hard to hold. But on Belcher Vestige, it's tough to get any more than three. The three bases are very straightforward to pick up. So we're going to wind up seeing a lot more of an aggressive play out of Polt, and a lot more difficulty defending out of Hyun. So suddenly Hyun is either going to have to go Mutalisk or start bringing the noise back to his opponent. That's what we saw Suppy do versus Polt to begin flooded with so many speed roaches. Or if you watch Star Tail Golden play, Golden has amazing defense with the Mutalink. Either way, you just don't get to lock down in the way that Hyun did in that last game.
There was so many various stages of the game, but there's something you said later that is just kind of crazy, because even when it comes down to it, usually we see this come into production anyway, but the lack of Spire, in that later game, and kind of that option to say, okay, well, maybe I'll start throwing some Corruptors in or going this way, just wasn't there. And, he built it, but then at the same time, that was right when he was forced to basically use his bank to bring out all those reinforcing units.
Oh, that's such a great moment to bring up, because I think that's one of the few moments that we've seen in this entire tournament where Hyun looked surprised. From his play, you could see that he was getting the Spire up to get those Corruptors, but then when it was done, he didn't get them.
He sort of
was like, okay, oh my God, I need the Spire. Oh my God, I need to make Lings to try to apply more pressure to try to take out the front. Oh my gosh, I don't even have enough gas to do that, so I'm going to start massing Queen, Infester, Ultralisk, which, as we've seen before, if that manages to get to a nice angle, if there's enough creep around, there's not really much that a Terran composition can do about it. The Ultralisks don't die.
Let's also talk about one other moment. We saw during the replay the whole, how many Banelings actually die to mines before they even got any sort of detonations. And, in those cases, the nice thing is sometimes the Banelings kill the mines. But if we think back to that point and Polt with his excellent mine spread, how do you think Hyun deals with that so that his Banelings become more effective on what could have been a killing blow if you would have had 50 Banelings left over?
Yeah, I really think that the big key for Hyun is just the map. That's a tough map to do that on, because your opponent's going to get four bases, which means he gets eight geysers, which means that he's going to wind up with enough Ravens, enough Battlecruise, enough everything to be able to take it out. On pretty much any other map, you can even let those Banelings get killed. It's kind of hard to prevent your opponent from getting that many mines. But on a smaller map, Polt's not even going to be able to sit back and set that minefield up. He's going to have to move out. He's going to have to get into a worse position. And if you even look at the units lost tab, we see that Hyun was at around, Polt was at around 28,000 in total units lost. And Hyun was at around 52,000. Just staggering the amount that Hyun lost in those final few engagements.
That's pretty crazy. Want to remind everyone, $10,000 is on the line for first place. This also is a WCS Tier 1 event, so 750 points goes to the winner, and then it sort of goes down from there. And we are going to have a PC replacement, so we've got a little bit of time before we jump into game two. If you've just joined us, this is a best of five. We're currently sitting 1-0 with Polt in the lead after a remarkable game one. And although we've got to wait a little bit for another game to start, I'm anxious to see if we're going to have as equally exciting matchups for the remainder of the series.
I will say that was a dream game one. That was so sensational. Acolon Waste, one of the more macro-heavy maps, because, again, easy to get four bases. Belcher Vestige, much more aggressive of a map. And if we look at the map pool, Neoplanet S, another extremely aggressive map. We haven't seen a lot of games on Frost. We haven't seen a lot of games on Korhal Floating Island yet. So these are all big variety. They'll test how strong your breadth of strategies are. Because, we talk a lot about fundamentals, macro, micro, map control, this sort of thing. The maps are different enough that the strategies you bring to the table need to be appropriately different.
Based off of the contrast of these two players' styles, too, before we got started, we talked about how Hyun was typically very, very strong once he hit that 200 with the reinforcements. This is the first time. I mean, we saw those amazing games with Hero in those similar situations, those back-and-forth battles, but this is the first time where Polt just kind of put a solid stop to that. And that, you know, alone was impressive. A lot of times you see those engagements, and when the trade happens, you know, you see the instant, you see the instant reinforcement, but and then the Terran goes down in supply as it slowly climbs back
yes,
up.
Definitely.
But it was amazing after that first engagement where Polt was. He still he was able to stay around that 150, 160, build back up to 200, but pretty impressive at that
and point. You know, one thing that's really difficult just in general in SC2 is to identify what's going on and to broadly change what you're doing. I mean, often what you'll see is a player who's good at, say, a Biomine style play, doing a lot of the aggression and drops. It's not a question of whether you're going to do it. You've already decided that before the game begins. It's just how well you choose to drop and how well you micro and place your mines. But Polk got the chance to see, wow, you have a lot of spore crawlers in your main. I can't even do
right.
the usual Biomine anymore. Okay, well, I will just start doing slow pushes back and forth with these medevacs. I'm not even going to be trying to drop at odd angles. I'm not even going to be trying to push. I'm going to go straight for battle cruisers. Polt decided that very swiftly. Even before his 3-3 was done, he was beginning to transition up into those battle cruisers. And that's really the whole reason why he was able to stay alive in those late stages.
You know, when you had the lockdown inside the main base, we've seen this a few times in some of the pro matches, as we've seen a lot of the creep moving forward, more or less a lot of times also with the swarm host style of play. But it would have been interesting to maybe see him bring some of those spores to the front line, as his creep was actually pretty far forward as he was pushing. You know, if anything, to get rid of a lot of those extra mines along the way. But Banelings did that. Unfortunately, that wasn't really their target. So again, I'm you know, very curious to see Polt having that one game advantage. And you guys have heard us give this speech before, how in a best of five, sitting with that one victory can open up a ton of options to you as you go into the second game. That could be from just playing very standard, throwing in some mind games to try to make your opponent think you're doing this, or throwing some aggression, or actually going for some aggression.
And you know, in terms of the momentum, I think Hyun has had a nice opportunity to get a breather. Often, you know, there's a two-minute break between games. We go on into the next game, and you can still be feeling frustrated, flustered. Polt can still be feeling confident, still living off that high of that great, great win. But now that we've had a little bit of a break, Hyun's going to have plenty of time to get himself recentered and calmed down.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for coming out for another MLG Pro Circuit event. We are going to take a quick commercial break. When we come back, we hope we are going live with game number two. So don't go away. The MLG Spring Championship Grand Final for StarCraft II continues in just a moment.